IVM.
Helping us pay our bills this week is PayTM Money.
On this episode of Paisa, Vaisa, I'm joined by Hansi Marotra, who runs the moneyhans.com, and by Alika from IVM. We are going to talk about a whole host of personal financial decisions, budgeting, investment and savings for women, and how to plan all those important decisions out. Stay tuned for that. Is your KYC taking days and weeks? Well, now you can actually complete your KYC verification on PayTM Money and also have it approved on the very same day. Guess what? Mine was approved within 30 minutes. So why delay when you can invest today? Ab mutual funds ke liye bhi PayTM karo. You can download the PayTM Money app on App Store or Play Store. Folks, welcome to Paisa Vaisa. I'm your host Anupam Gupta, B50 on Twitter, and this episode is a listener special. Yes, I just love getting listener feedback, and one feedback that I got a couple of weeks ago was from a young girl. She said that she's 23, just started her first job, and she was looking for ways, you know, to figure out budgeting, investment and savings specific to her. And I thought that's a fantastic topic, and I reached out to the one person who I know is the absolute rock star in this. And it's always great to have a returning guest, and I have with me Hansi Marotra, who runs moneyhans.com. Last time she was here for the Diwali special. Building that money house is a fantastic process, it's a great framework. Hansi, welcome back to the show. It's just so great to have you here. You're the best person I can think of for this. Okay, so let's start off here. You know, for me as an old timer, so to say, it's very difficult not to give traditional advice to someone, you know, who's probably half pay. I'll say like, acha, you need to save, you need to do this, you need to do that, you need to work for 20, 30 years. Then I get responses like, yaar, bas kya hai? You're an old timer. Aajkal ka generation aisa hai ki we want to take a break. We do 2 years, 3 years of work. We go backpacking here, backpacking there. We don't want to own, right? We want to rent, we want to do Uber, we want to do this, we want to do that. Let's start with a framework, right? Because I'm pretty sure that financial planning, whichever way you look at it, whichever generation you look at it, is important. Anyone who's working, anyone who has a career, needs to save money for the future. It's critical. It's important. How you do it is on you, right? Let's look at building your money house, okay, for someone who's this young, okay, and who wants to meet certain goals. How would she do it?
Okay. Great. So you remember the money house, right?
I do, of course.
I would say that I have tested it on young people, old people, poor people, rich people, pretty much everyone, and it works for everyone. Okay. Now, she is a young woman, so there are two things different. One is she's young, and two, she's a woman. Let me address the woman part first. I think women technically should be exactly the same way as men in terms of their finances, except they have some extra roadblocks. One, they don't get paid as much as men do. That's a reality, and that's been proven. There's a gender pay gap, right? So we don't negotiate as well. So there's one aspect. So over time, that builds up to getting paid less, therefore saving less, therefore investing less, and therefore ending up with less. So that's one aspect. Two, to make things worse, we then take time off to have babies, to have kids. And we are responsible for them, so we want to take longer time off to be able to bring them up well. So that means we are now relying on our husbands and families and stuff. Third, we tend to live longer than men. So technically, we should plan more than men do rather than less. So I think everything combined, it just makes finance even more important for women. And yet, women have this fear of numbers or maths and saying, oh, we don't understand numbers. It's we'll take the medicine part and boys can take the engineering part or things like that. So I think, so that's why I am, in fact, the Money Hunts is actually aimed primarily at women and young people. So she's the perfect candidate for that. So that's the framework. Now coming back to, the framework that I talked about, which is the money house, applies equally to women. They just have to adjust it for their situation.
And if they want to check out the framework, it's on your website, which is themoneyhans.com, themoneyhans.com.
Correct. And the framework is the money house, which is basically divide your wealth and your assets and your goals, everything basically in three buckets. The foundation, the pillars, and the fun roof. How you build a house, right? The foundation is things you cannot afford to lose, which is basically the most important thing is your health, your ability to earn an income. That's most important. And then you add, depending on how sort of safe you feel, your house, some emergency cash. And then everything to insure all of these. So insurances, that's foundation. The pillars are things that take you up in life. So there are two things. One is your ability to earn income needs to get better and better and better, with the test of which is that you need to get paid more every year, not just inflation, but productivity or real increase. And the other one is ideally you should save for your retirement from the very beginning. So put a SIP, SIP into an equity fund or multiple funds or a passive fund and leave it for the long term. So that's the pillars. And the roof is your fun roof, which means you have to have fun in life. And to me, that applies to everyone, okay? Whether you're young, old, middle-aged like me, any age. Now, that definition also is things that you can afford to lose. So if it pays off, you become the happiest, the best, the richest in the world. If it doesn't pay off, you can walk away from it. So people who get rich because of that fun roof. They put all their talent into one thing. They leverage it to the hilt and they have a distribution through the whole world. So think Zuckerberg or any film star or anyone. That's because they've done that. So if you didn't do that early enough in life, you would never, ever, ever, I think, achieve whatever you want to do. So that's the framework. Now, like I said, apply that to women. You have to say, okay, for example, your foundation. Parents are there, whether you're a girl or a boy. But like I said, sometimes girls don't get as much education, for example, as boys do. So then you have to overcompensate and so on.
Let's start with products then, okay? Going on to each and, you know, each of the three aspects of the money house that you spoke about. Let's start with the foundation, okay? Basic minimum financial products that each woman must have at the start of her career. You spoke about health. It's so important, right? Because when you're young, that's the last thing you'll care about, right? So let's look at specific products that anyone, okay, should have at that point of time.
So the basic thing is obviously you need to insure your health insurance. When you're living with your parents are your health insurance. And that something happens to you, they take you to hospital and they pay for everything. So that's kind of okay. But as soon as you start earning an income, you need to start thinking about building up to it, right? If you get your first job at 22, 23, by 28, 29, you kind of are a fully functioning adult and should be out of your parents' net. So you need to build up to it. I obviously think that you need to save. Now, I've actually, in the first few years of my career, back when I was 21, I used to wait at tables at night. I used to be a financial advisor during the day.
Wow.
I used to pay for my own education. I built, as soon as I got my distinctions and finished my diploma, that's when I got a full-time job. And I started saving into a basic savings kind of money market fund type thing because I wanted to do further education. So you keep collecting your emergency cash, and if you think you've collected more than you need, then you can kind of reinvest. So in the early part of your careers, you're always reinvesting in yourself.
So there are two things out here, right? One would be to have a basic insurance, let's just call it health insurance. Okay.
It's definitely health insurance. But like I said, some people don't, they themselves don't get it because their parents have it.
Okay, sure.
But yeah.
Eventually, you need to have
of course,
one. Whether
of
you have
course.
It at 28, 29, 30, whatever it is. And chances are that your company also might give you that.
Don't take
exactly.
the company one.
That's what I'm saying.
Because you will move jobs.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's no point because each time you move, you have to start all over again.
Right.
The group insurance policy doesn't quite work in India as well.
Right. So you've got a basic health insurance plan that you need. And the
Correct.
Second is at least some money that you need to put into it.
Money market fund or a FD.
Okay.
As an emergency cash.
Which serves as, okay, that's it.
As emergency cash.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you start accumulating more. As I said, I believe early part of a career, I mean, some people can start equities and I'll talk about that later. But to me, that ability to earn income is the most important at that stage in life.
Hmm.
So, yeah.
And
sorry, I should take that one more thing on insurance.
Please.
There are two different types of insurance. There's health insurance, which pays for your medical expenses when you
yes.
go to hospital. There's also a concept called income protection.
Okay.
Which,
interesting.
If you get sick, it could be temporary, like a broken leg or broken arm, or it could be more permanent, like a disease or an accident that's a bit more serious. Who will take care of your other living expenses, whether it's your rent, your food, your whatever? That is covered by a separate thing called income protection or salary continuance or temporary disablement, sometimes temporary and permanent disablement. In India, it tends to be a lump sum. In other parts of the world, and I think there are some policies in India that are starting to do this, they give you a monthly income.
Okay.
Up to 75% of the income that is lost.
Okay.
In India, like I said, nobody does it, not even older people, let alone young people. But an example that I told you before we walked in is my sister. She got diagnosed with something very early on in her life, which meant that for the next 10 years, she couldn't work. And even after that, I mean, a lot of cajoling and rehab. So yeah, if you are, something hits you, whether it's a disease or accident, it's not that if you die, die is the easy part, actually. If you live, who will take care of you? So you need to start thinking about it very young. And imagine if you hit by it in your 20s.
That's tough. I'm really sorry to hear that happened in your family. The emergency fund, any thoughts on that? You know, how many months expenses or anything?
Depends on expenses, right? So let's talk about budgeting, okay? And that kind of leads to emergency cash, I think sort of 6 months worth of expenses you should keep. Again, depending on how close you are to friends and family, right? I mean, if they can back you up, great. If not, definitely more. It leads me to budgeting, right? So it's, I think when you earn, say, 100 rupees, 50 is your need to have expenses. So rent, food, maybe even transport goes into that.
Yep.
That's your benchmark. Another 20% should be in comforts. And another 30% should be savings. My rule of thumb has been I've saved literally one third all my life.
Hmm.
All my life, even when I was in my 20s. It comes in handy. I mean, I may reinvest the saving into education, but at least I saved, right? I put it into a separate bucket, into a separate fund. So when you save 6 months worth of expenses, it's the 6 months of the 50% that you need to live on, right? Then you're assuming that you're cutting back on your comforts. If you're no longer employed and whatever, you cannot also then go and party every night and drink and movies and all that.
It's going to be my next question. What if I just redeem the emergency fund and go backpacking in Europe? How about... Okay.
Backpacking is not an emergency. No, emergency is a real emergency.
And you should save up for that.
Yes.
Yeah, you should take out expenses for your backpack. I mean, there's nothing wrong with backpacking. It's a fantastic thing. But, you know, typically save for that as a goal, right? Would that be the right approach?
Correct. That, to me, is not a foundation sort of goal. Then that gets to sort of, I put that as a fun roof kind of thing. As in like, if you do it, great. It's a great experience. If you don't get to do it, it's not the end of your life. Mm. It's okay. You will do it at some other point in life, right? So you start saving for it separately.
Yeah. Next step, let's go to the pillars. How do we work on that? Now that, you know, you've saved for insurance, you've done your emergency fund investing, you know, what next?
So then, there are two things, right? Ability to earn income. So you keep investing in that. Like I said, I took that savings that I had put aside, that 30%, and 2-3 years I saved. And then I went and did another diploma. And then I did my CFA. And then I did my Wharton course. So every few years I went and reinvested in my ability to earn an income. But I also started, and in Australia it's compulsory, a monthly contribution to my pension fund, which I put 100% in equities, in fact, in Asian equities.
Mm.
From an Australia point of view, Australians would invest in Aussie equities and international equities, global developed markets. I put it into developing markets 20 years ago.
High risk.
High risk, at because I've got 40 years.
Why not?
So if you, and this is the thing, when people say I'm low risk or high risk, I'm conservative or I'm risk taking, there's no such thing.
Yeah.
I think it's BS. I think if you divide your money up into 2-3 buckets and align them with the time horizon you have for that bucket. So in my money market fund, I'm ultra conservative. I would not even take credit risk. I will take no one. If someone promises me extra 1-2%, I will not take it. In my pillars, I go to the hilt, highest risk equities possible, because I have 40 years to run. So who am I? Am I a split personality? Of course not. I'm just dividing my money up into and aligning them with the goals that I have.
Okay, so two things out there. First is investing in yourself. Like you said, you did the CFA, you did the MBA, so for an individual person, he or she has to figure out what are the 2-3 things that he or she needs to do to make sure that his income keeps on increasing.
My bad.
So that's something that the listener will have to figure out.
Correct.
Different things work for different people.
Well, I think you have to. I think I don't know anyone who, even at 20-something, can say, I've done my degree or my education and I no longer need to learn anything new. That's a recipe for disaster. I think even in our 40s, you and me need to keep learning, let alone 20s. I think by the time they reach 30, there'd be new careers that we've never heard of. So I think there is no stopping. So for example, a young friend of mine in her 20s, when she was early 20s, she came to me and said she wanted to become a model. She wanted to be Miss India. I had this much money. She only had 1 lakh that she got as a payment for something. do you think I can reinvest in a portfolio? Can I invest in a portfolio? Do you think that's indulgence? And I said, well, no. To anybody else, it might have been indulgence to look good for vanity. But for her, if she wanted to enter Miss India or be a model, that's an investment. That go ahead and... So anything that helps you earn more income, to me, is reinvesting in that bucket. It could be doing courses. I do online digital marketing courses. I go and learn about video editing. I go and do whatever. So depending on what it is you want to do in life, you need to keep becoming better and better and better. In fact, one more tip I said last time, and I'm saying it this time, it's very hard to be in the top 1% or 10% of a career. And that's what you need to be good, to be able to be in demand. The problem is not everybody is good at it. So my suggestion is be good at two or three things, the intersection of which will make you unique. So I was good in finance and I was also good in arts, in marketing or whatever. Other people are good in coding and also in finance. Then they're good in fintech, right? So that intersection will help you. And I think especially for young people today, that would be something they have to work on.
And on that note, we take a small break.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast. If you're not following us on social media, please make sure that you do. We're IVM Podcast on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. So just wanted to make a note for everybody. We do have this new Alexa skill that we've created for Cyrus Says. If you have an Alexa, please say play Cyrus Says, and you should be able to listen to the podcast on the Alexa from now on. Speaking of Cyrus Says, this week, Cyrus is joined by Dr. Vishakha Shivdasani. They talk about healthy eating and nutrition. And Vishakha clears Cyrus's confusion about the professions of nutritionists, dietitian, doctors, and health coaches. This week on Geek Fruit, Tejas and Dinka bring on producer Zoya to discuss Interstellar and the Dark Knight trilogy and rank the on-screen portrayals of Batman. On the Sponge podcast, Ambi Parmeshwaran talks about what makes for a great client and agency relationship and how not to get caught in intra-company crossfires. On MF101, Anupam talks to Manish Dangi, co-CIO Debt at Aditya Birla Sun Life Mutual Fund, about debt mutual funds, its characteristics, and current scenarios. We've launched a brand new sports show called What a Player, where the hosts give you insights about the latest games, scores, and strategies. Do check it out for updates about the ongoing T20 Cricket League. New episodes are out every morning. This week on Dating is Garbage, our hosts invite the first couple on the show, Naveen Narona and Abhishek Tundel, to talk about the green flags of dating. On Croc's Tales, Anand Sivakumara narrates tales of friendship, dating and love, all centered around the phrase, Kuch Meetha Ho Jaye. This week on our Kannada podcast, Thale Arate, C.V. Madhukar discusses how philanthropy and impact investing can make a difference in our society. And with that, let's get on with your show.
And welcome back to the show. I am with Hansi Marotra, who runs moneyhunts.com. I'm joined with Alika also, who has a question, a very, very, very pertinent question. Hansi, let's get into a specific thing out here because we're talking about women who are starting off their careers. Alika has a very interesting question here.
Right. So when we start out our careers, we don't necessarily have any income coming in right now. We want to go look for jobs. Especially as women, we have a little bit more pressure to, you know, dress up and look a little bit more appealing because that's a way people consider us for jobs. So we have to now get, you know, control our income in terms of, you know, where do we spend it? We need to spend it on things like clothes and a little bit of makeup to, you know, appeal to employers to get jobs.
Where am I going to have the cash left to put in?
Yes, so balancing that along with savings is a little bit of a tightrope thing, right?
Okay, so I think the pressure we feel is the pressure we let ourselves feel. And again, there is a concept called pink tax, where right, even for the same things, women are charged more just because it happens to be in pink,
yes,
right?
Yes, this is true.
Similarly, I think we take it upon ourselves to say, oh, we have to look good, therefore we have to spend more on makeup, more on high heels, more on clothes, because we have to look different every day compared to the men who can wear the same thing every day, right? I think all of that is a myth, okay? And I'm 40 plus, okay? So it's 20 years ago when I was 20-something. Mm-hmm. Can you believe I only learned to put makeup on 3 years ago? Oh. I kid you not. Look at any of my old pictures, no makeup. So no, I think it's a pressure that we put on ourselves. Sure, you need to be well-groomed, okay? Any employer will want you well-groomed. So nails have to be, like, for example, instead of going for a manicure and having a nice polished nails, you can cut it really short, and that's, so long as they're neat and clean, you're fine. Shoes. There used to be a time where employers would demand wear high heels. That is illegal. They cannot do that to you. So if you're comfortable in wearing the same shoes every day, go for it. You can decide to wear something high heels if you feel like it. That's your choice. But don't put it on the employer or any pressure. Same thing. There was an experiment that a woman did, and it's talked about it in personal, one of the blogs. Men feel they wear the same clothes every day. Zuckerberg and so on, examples are quoted. Women feel the pressure to wear something different. So what she did was she found two or three staple skirts. I think it was black and gray or black and white, something like that she did. Basically, two or three, so she can rotate and dry clean and wash and whatever. But this same color combination. Every single day, she just rotated those two, one or two jackets, one or two shirts, and one or two skirts. No one noticed. She just picked something that looked really absolute amazing on her. Mm-hmm. And she bought two or three of slight variations, and she wore that every day. So long as you turn up well turned out, no one cares and cannot make you. Okay, so I think it's the pressure that women put on ourselves to be able to do that. Now, therefore, you have a choice to make now. It's not that somebody's making you. You say, okay, if I'm only earning 100 rupees, whatever the number is 20,000 rupees or 50,000 rupees, 50% goes in rent and food and transport, which is basic necessity. 20% comfort, you have to make do with that 20% comfort, and you still have to save 30% and reinvest in your education. I personally wouldn't reinvest in looking good, but if it's absolutely necessary, sure, for the first time, whatever. But over time, I think you need to, your work needs to be better, not your appearance. If I'm your employer and your work is damn good and you are reskilling yourself, I would definitely pay you for that.
Yeah, isn't there a way out also out here, like saying that maybe you can front load your expense, or at least in the first few months, you know, just be systematic about it. Just be very disciplined about it.
Yeah, but yes, that, I agree with you. Once, so that's the staple goods that you buy, right? Yeah. So by the way, I wear the same jeans the last 20 years. I wear the same lots of things because I bought quality, right? So definitely I don't believe in the use and throw culture. Definitely, yes, you can front load a little bit. Maybe your parents can help and stuff as well. Buy good pieces, but don't fall into the pressure of having to look different every day and keep up with the fashion. Not for work. In your personal life, do what you want. But for work, to say that you feel the pressure, I think you have to stand up and say, no, I will not feel the pressure.
And of course, be committed to your financial goals. I mean, there might be one or two months where you go off, but come back.
Come back to it.
Don't overspend your credit card, stuff like that. That's basic stuff.
You shouldn't have a credit card at that point.
Okay. Yeah, that's a separate show on its own.
Yeah. It is actually the credit card. Okay, so just absolutely, credit cards are just a convenient way of for payment. Okay, it should be ideally a debit card. Mm. Okay, use a debit card. Okay. Do not get a credit card at that point until you learned that you can save 30%. Do not get a credit card.
Or you get, you know, you don't pay your credit card bill and then suddenly, boom, you're paying a lot.
20% interest. No, God, I mean, yeah.
Aliga, that's good for you.
Yeah, that sounds good.
Fantastic. Anzi, pillar number two. Okay, we've covered the foundation, we've covered this. Let's look at, probably look upon this as a life cycle thing. Someone who's now, I don't know, maybe in early 30s, and now the goals are changing now, right? Because you've sorted the first few, 5-10 years of your career. What next?
Well, they're probably getting married and having babies at that age. Oh. And I did. So I can totally understand everybody else doing it. Again, another cousin of mine just got married recently, a niece actually. And we got talking about, I was talking with the groom. And it's like, you know, so much we're spending on the wedding itself. And it's like, yeah, I can't believe it. I'd rather take that money and put that into a house deposit. So there are two aspects. So the groom usually doesn't necessarily want to spend on the wedding. They want to spend it on the marriage. Which is long term. The bride always insists on looking good on that day, and then kind of doesn't matter what happens to race. I think both these things, whether you, what you spend on the wedding day itself, whether it's your lehenga, again, my lehenga I've never worn ever again, like once in your life, it's not worth buying for lakhs and lakhs and lakhs. So I think now there is that whole rent culture that's come in, whether it's for cars through Uber and Ola and all that, whether it's for houses, so there's co-living and student living and all that sort of stuff. There is same thing for clothes. You can actually rent clothes from the runway, right?
What?
There's a
Seriously?
Whole bunch of, yes, there is. Yes. There is. For things that you day to day wear, you want to obviously own your clothes,
yes,
right?
I'm talking about this one special day of my entire life, and you know, I'm going to spend like mad. You're saying that I can rent my clothes?
You can.
Wow.
You can.
Okay.
And I'm saying to you that I think, like, she's not, Alika's nodding, right?
So yeah,
I think that
you can rent a tux.
You can rent a tux. You can rent a lehenga. You can rent a designer thing. Why do you have to spend?
Sounds
so
good.
Back then, 20 years ago, I didn't have that option. Today, I didn't do it. So I'd say, do it. Do it. Because this is one I say to women and generally to everyone. I think what the pressure that we feel to look good on our wedding day or arrive in a fancy car or wear branded clothes, all that pressure, it's nothing compared to what I have right now, which is I don't have to ever work again. Imagine turning up to a cafe and saying to your friends, oh, you have to go to work tomorrow? I don't. That is beats, I think, every other feeling. So I think all the little pressures that you feel, you have to balance it a little bit and say, how can I actually still look good look good for the pictures? In the end, if everything is being done for the Instagram pictures, really, do you have to spend lakhs and lakhs to get there? I don't think you do.
I'm sure you can set a budget for your marriage and then figure out where to things.
For your wedding or your marriage? This is the point. I keep reminding people of the two differences.
Marriage
right?
is lifelong, wedding is a ceremony.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
So I think the wedding, same thing. Okay. Now, having said that, I'm assuming you're dating someone or you're getting married to someone. You need to have the money talk. The talk with your husband to be, okay, or your wife to be, depending on who's listening. You need to sort out your finances together in terms of who brings what to the marriage from beforehand. If anything, maybe in their 20s, neither of you have anything, unless one of you is really from a rich family, in which case their parents will probably have a separate trust somewhere or prenup or all that sort of stuff.
Destination wedding, stuff like that.
That's the wedding, again, the what they bring to the marriage.
Sure.
But my point is you have to have a conversation. And I think you are allowed to ask and you should ask your spouse about their finance habits. If you're saving 30%, they better be doing the same. As in, you need to have equal. Otherwise, I guarantee you, the biggest fight that couples have is about money. So, in fact, siblings too. But anyway, the point is that so that conversation needs to happen. So in your 30s, when you're getting married and you're starting a new life and you're considering, in my case, for example, when I was considering having babies, I told my husband, you know, there'll be 2-3 years that I won't be working. I will save for it, but you have to contribute too. It's not just my thing. So you better put it into a separate account. And don't you dare ask me what I'm spending it on. Because if I have to ask you for something, that would kind of upset me, politely, and I'm using polite words. So that was a conversation that needs to happen because the kids, after all, are both of yours.
Yeah.
So that's another, in your 30s, that's the conversation you need to have.
Any changes here in savings patterns, allocations? You know, maybe if you've got an SIP going, previously you had it in an emergency fund. Do you think that there is a need out here to look at equities or even increase your savings or anything out here?
The two things that don't change is that emergency cash stays emergency cash. It's just that it gets bigger because your expenses have got bigger, right? So it was 6 months when you were in your 20s, it was maybe say 50,000 rupees was enough to live on. It was six times that, right? When you got older, it's now a lakh, six times that.
Right.
So that gets bigger, but the multiple stays the same. And same thing with your SIP into an equity fund long-term for your retirement does not change. If anything, you're getting... So it's two ways of doing it. If you started early and you put 10% of your income into that long term and you keep it at 10%. Remember, your income is growing over time, right?
Yep.
You keep it at that, you will be fine. If you didn't start early enough, you started later, then you need to keep increasing that percentage over time.
Okay.
But again, depends on your income, right? I cannot ask you to save more or invest more if you don't have any enough income. If anything, you're going down in your income, right? And kid you not, when you go back to work, you would not be earning as much as your male counterparts, right? Because you've now lost out on 1-3 years of your life.
Yeah.
I would try to keep up in terms of, there's so many long distance and free courses, edX, Coursera, a whole bunch of them, that edX, Coursera are free.
Yeah.
So keep up your skill set is the only advice I would give while you take time off.
Excellent.
So once you reach your 30s, roughly around that age, your health also starts to become a little wobbly. I mean, there's some smaller things which start up. So at that point, do you increase your emergency fund savings, or is it okay at the same gradient that it's going on at the moment?
The insurance premium should take care of that, the health insurance.
So firstly, if you're 30s, nothing is wrong with your health. Okay.
That's the point.
When I say not everything is money.
Yeah.
Not everything is money. Okay.
Okay.
A bunch of things in your life. In fact, what is wealth? Let me go back to the very basics. What is wealth? Wealth is the ability to do what you want to do to achieve your highest potential.
Okay.
Which you will not have if you don't have your health. Right. So I think if you compromise on, for example, I see people taking a rickshaw and inhaling the fumes of a bus.
Right.
And they think that's cheaper than taking an Uber. And it's like, that's false economy.
Okay, okay. Those are choices. You know, that's
those
kind
are not,
of...
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying to you. So health comes first.
Okay.
Yeah, but there's something like some people get asthma really fast, especially if they live in Mumbai because of the smog.
So you can probably cover that with the health insurance.
The health insurance.
Ensure that your policy takes care of every specific risk, and each and every year review your policy, stuff like that. Okay, so
Correct.
The health. Alika, I'm sure you've got a couple of questions out here. You want to go with them? Please. Yeah, go ahead.
So as a woman, I feel like safety is a big issue that I need to address with my income as well, because I need to stay in a place which is relatively safe for me. I need to take transport which is relatively safe for me. And with safe, everything I try to increase my safety also increases the amount I need to pay for it. For example, I need to take an Uber instead of the train, or I need to stay in an area which is slightly more upmarket just so that it's a little bit safer. So balancing that is a little tricky, especially coming into a new city, looking for a new job.
Okay, I absolutely agree with you. So that I don't have an answer for. I think women do end up getting paid, or rather getting charged more, taxed more, if you will, because of the safety issues. So I will say yes, definitely pick a safer place. Maybe compromise on other things. So for example, you can share more. Mm-hmm. With other girls.
Right.
You can also negotiate that with your employer. I think most of them are open. They obviously understand, especially if you have a female boss, but even otherwise they understand. So I know every one of my girlfriends gets more allowance for taxis at night. As soon after 7 o'clock or something, they get taxi allowance. So things like that you can negotiate. I also agree with not staying too far away from your work. There's scientific studies that show that if you stay more than 45 minutes away globally, it starts to affect your morale. I can understand that in India, I would say maybe an hour. Any more than an hour, I can understand it actually affecting your day-to-day life. So I think that is something you just have to build in into your essentials when you're doing your budgeting. So no arguments there. Just on that thing, I would also say that, but there are other ways to also ensure your safety, right? So for example, you said taxis versus trains. There, I'm not really sure, because to be fair to the government, they make sure there are ladies' compartments. There are things you can carry with you, camera or phone or devices to alert. So there are other things you can do so you don't have to completely shun all public transport or other things. So I think we shouldn't, as women, shrink and into a corner. We should actually make a presence felt. I think if you have an issue, raise it with your employer, with your public transport, with whatever. I think we should definitely fight rather than give up.
Yeah. Also, a little bit of a offshoot question. You said that when we, at least I have found that once we reach maybe late 30s, early 40s, a lot of people's health starts to get a little wobbly. There are a little bit of deterioration. Some issues start to crop up. At this point, do you increase your emergency saving funds or is it okay going on the same gradient that it's always been going on?
So I think your health is your most important thing. I think you should look after it. You shouldn't cut corners. I believe in your 20s and 30s, you should be able to look after your health like you look after your wealth and be fine with lots of fitness and stuff. But I think once you reach your late 30s, early 40s, I agree, you should definitely go for a health checkup every single year. I think you should build that into your health insurance as opposed to touch your emergency cash. The emergency cash is 6 times expenses. Say, for example, it's whatever expenses you see at that point, which has already increased anyway compared to your 20s, right? So I think it's the multiple of as an emergency cash stays the same. Your health insurance and health checkups go up.
And my final question is, what are your views on gold and real estate as good investment options?
For women specifically or for anyone?
Yes. Mm. Well, mostly for women specifically.
Okay. So firstly, I think investments are gender agnostic. Okay. So they don't care about whether a woman bought it or a man bought it. So two things. So gold. So people say women should buy gold because for their wedding. Mm-hmm. They actually don't mean it for their wedding only that day. They also mean it for their marriage, in that it's a gold is a very unique case where it's small. You can wear it should something happen to you or it's an emergency. You literally what you're wearing, you can walk out and go to any pawn shop and convert it into cash. It's actually very transportable, dividable, all of that stuff, divisible, I should say. So gold is a unique asset class. So I'd say, and the history of it, the last 5,000 years, means that historically has done well. But since the 70s, when the gold standard no longer applies, the returns have been a lot more muted. Who knows what the situation will be going forward? Post the global financial crisis, there's another question mark about gold being perhaps the gold the reserve currency. The short answer is treat gold as an insurance policy. Mm-hmm. So have a little bit on you. Like I said, it's for women especially. It's yours. It's on you. You can walk out with it. You can use it in emergencies. But I don't see any other good reason just because you're a woman, you should have it. You should wear more gold. I don't believe in any of that. Just interestingly, I have a skin reaction. As I've got older, I can only now wear gold. And I used to hate gold until now. Now I can only, everything else reacts. Oh. So I think that way, yeah, just a small, no more than 5, maybe maximum 10% of your overall wealth. But frankly, even that is questionable. But certainly consider it a little bit. Real estate is, again, whether it's for men or women, doesn't matter. I think having your own house is nice, but overpaying for it is not. I think you should only ever buy real estate when it is cheaper than usual. What do I mean by that? You can look at the rental yield. So for example, what rent you would pay for an equivalent apartment, convert that into a per annum figure compared to the price. So for example, say it's a 1 crore apartment and you're paying only 20,000 rupees a month. So multiply that by 12, that's your annual figure. That as a percentage of the 1 crore, that's your yield. Compare that to what is the interest cost you would pay. That gives you just a sense of whether real estate at that point in that city is expensive or not. I'm saying to you, if the gap is huge, then do not buy real estate, even if it's for your own home. There will be other points in life where it will become cheaper. It goes into 20, 30-year cycles. Mm-hmm. I, in my 30s, did not buy real estate until my late 30s, when 2008 happened. I got opportunity of a lifetime when real estate fell so much in the city that I bought that I then went and picked it up. And within 2 years, it doubled. So to me, even if it's for your own home, don't fall into the trap that, oh, it's in your own home, therefore pay whatever they're asking. No, it's not. It's the biggest thing that you will buy in your lifetime for a long, long time to come. So don't overpay for it. So gold and real estate, like I said, just because your parents did well, there was a reason why they did well, because interest rates in that last 40 years have only come down, which boosts the value of assets. So they did well. Therefore, they mean well when they give you that advice. But in today's era, that's no longer relevant. So you have to judge your investments from where we are today.
Fantastic. And Alika, any more questions?
No, as of now, I think you've answered all my questions.
Thank you for joining us. Hansi, last question. From me, in your experience, and you've got really good experience out here, what are the top 3 or top 5 or just generally mistakes that you keep on hearing often?
Oh, wow. Okay.
Long list, is it?
It's a long list. Yes, it is.
So, go for the top 3, probably.
One of them, I think this, while we're talking on the topic of real estate, the notion that rent is wasted money and you must buy your own home as soon as possible, as soon as you get your first job. I think that is just so misplaced. I think buying real estate is a valuation decision, and you should never do it in your 20s when you don't even know where you're going to live. At some point, once you settle in your career and stuff, that's when you decide where and how and all that. So you should never buy real estate in your 20s unless it happens to be a time when it's really, really cheap. Okay, so you should the timing of real estate decisions should be based on valuation of the real estate, not your age. So that's
okay,
one.
Sure.
And therefore, rent is perfectly fine. In fact, I'd say, like I said, the renting, the sharing economy means that rent is now cool. I mean, yep, sharing is now cool. The other thing, same, we talked about gold. It's a very common notion that everyone must have gold because it did so well and it's been around for so long. Again, look at why it had done well. And I read a whole book about it. I read a lot about it. So there was a reason why, and I think that reason still holds, in fact. But don't just buy blindly. Do your research. Things like equity is risky. Mm-hmm. Well, it is risky. That's why it has high return. But you need to let it run. So I think the notion that you are risk averse or not, again, there's no such thing in the literature. So you just divide your money up. And one portion that you're putting for your long-term wealth, just invest in equities and let it run. People don't seem to understand that they just because daily valuation is available doesn't mean you have to look at it. I don't look at my pension statement for years at a time. It comes by mail, purposely done, not by email, not by online, because I don't want to look at it. And it served me really well. So I think the notion that somehow markets are risky or everything else is, the whole world is wrong. They don't give me returns. They don't give me a job. They don't give me this. They don't give me that. Well, no, it's you. You have to improve yourself, whether it's learning the art of not reacting to markets, whether it's learning the art of skilling yourself and therefore getting a better job, learning the art of not needing a job, saying, okay, you know what? In today's world, who needs a job? I'm going to be employer rather than employee. I will go and employ other people. So all of those things I find... I get very sad when I see people in their 20s with these notions.
Sure.
I think it's something that they have to unlearn to be able to learn new things.
Great. Last part of our show. How can listeners get in touch with you? You're doing a whole lot of interesting stuff. There's you on YouTube. There's your website. There's your Twitter handle. You're like, so just tell us about that.
So interestingly, thanks for the opportunity to talk about women and investing today.
Thank you for coming over.
I'm actually making a whole show on this very topic. My new podcast that I'm working on should be out soon. It's called Meri Pyari Sahelia, where I'm talking to my girlfriends from various different backgrounds. Okay, I come from a small town near Kanpur, what's called Unnao. So I have friends from there who are middle class homemakers. I have women who've done extremely well in corporate life, in business. They're single moms. There's very rich people. There's very poor people, all of that. So I'm talking to all of them one by one, and I'm dissecting their journeys and saying what are the key takeaways that they've had and also what they can do better. So that podcast is coming soon. So for all the listeners today who enjoy today, there's a lot more coming on that front with other people's stories.
Super.
And then I have my website, and every other social media has the same handle, The Money Hans, H-A-N-S, Hansika Hans.
Fantastic.
That has everything that I do on videos, audio, articles, everything.
I just love returning guests when they come back to the show. Hansi, thank you so much for joining us. There's one thing that's changed when you were here the last time last year and now. I ask all my guests two standard questions. Number one, tell our listeners about some mistake that you did in your life, okay, money-wise. And what did you learn from it, okay? I'm sure you've not done many, but I'm sure that, you know, all of us are vulnerable to that. And second, any recommendation, you know, for a book or for a podcast or for a movie, anything that you have for our listeners. Let's go with the first one. Any mistake?
Oh, I have lots of mistakes.
Financial.
Financial, yeah. Yes. And funny, and that's ironic because obviously I studied finance. Yeah. But here's the mistake I made. I also married a finance guy. And I thought he was smarter than I was. So even though I was teaching other people diversification, he convinced me that this one particular area of investments that he was a specialist, had become a specialist in, was a foolproof way for funding my impending motherhood. So he's like, okay, when you take time off, this will give a 15% yield and therefore put all our money into that one thing. Oh. So even though I was teaching other people to diversify, I thought he and I combined were smarter than everybody else. So we thought we will not diversify. Big mistake.
Oh.
It blew up.
Ouch.
There was a hailstorm. There was Chinese something. This was an agricultural bunch of farms, vineyards and stuff. So we lost all our money at that point.
That would have hurt.
And I've lost money not once but multiple times. Okay, there's a time before that in the 99-2000 boom and crash that I'd invested in my employer In hindsight, I think I'd put all my talent into one thing and leveraged it. But again, lack of diversification was a big thing back then as well. So I lost my money back then, and then again in whatever, 2005, 2006. And then I started life all over again. So everything I am today, I only made in the last 4 years of working.
It kind of reminds me of Warren Buffet.
Wow.
So you need to, and the thing is that I think some mistakes, you need to make them yourself. Even though you hear other people, but you just have to do it, because then you realize that reading about it and living through it are two different things.
Right.
Recommendations?
Lots of books. Oh gosh, it's very hard.
Something you've read recently then?
There are lots of books. There's one on investing, except I'm forgetting the name, the full name. The little book of something is stock market investing, something like that. It's the author's name is Joel Greenblatt.
Okay, yeah.
G-O-E-L, Greenblatt. On investing, that's a brilliant small book. You can read it in a couple of hours and you'll be done. Good basics. I think in terms of life hacks, like I said, to me, health and your happiness are more important than money. Money is just a medium. The wealth is actually being able to have your health and happiness. I think people forget that. For that, there's a podcast called The Knowledge Project by a guy called Shane Parrish. He has a website called Farnham Street Blog. So either Google Farnham Street Blog and find the podcast, or just go directly to the podcast, iTunes and whatever, and find The Knowledge Project. I think he interviews some very interesting people that are a lot more about life hacks and productivity and happiness and things like that. A little bit of investing here and there. I think that's well worth your time. I think reading is well worth your time.
And talking to you is well worth my time. I'm sure that it is for listeners also. Aliga and Hansi, of course, thank you so much for joining us. Folks, that's a wrap. You were listening to Hansi Mehrotra, who runs the website, themoneyhans.com. Hansi, thank you so much.
Thank you.
No material on the show should be considered as financial advice. The material on the show is for informational purposes only. Please consult a financial advisor before taking any investment decision.
How aware do you think you are of your laws and rights? Do you look up to laws when you are caught up in situations? Do you know what your rights are when you're stuck somewhere bad? Well, here's a show that can help you move an inch closer to being aware of what your rights are. Tune into Know Your Kanoon with me, Amber Rana. This is a podcast meant to answer all your law-related queries. Catch Know Your Kanoon every week on the IVM website or the app or anywhere you get your podcast from.
Advertising is dead. Yep, you heard me right. Advertising is dead. We're all in the content business now. Let's not call it news, TV, radio, etc., etc. It's all content, and we're in the middle of this weirdly exciting phase where all the borders and lines that have been drawn over decades has been swept away by this lovely thing called the internet. We're a show where we don't dwell on just the stuff that is now, but rather the wider stuff about advertising, media, content, and the whole goddamn circus surrounding it. Tune in every Tuesday for our weekly unboxing of the mystery box we used to call advertising. I'm Varun Dugirala, co-founder and content chief at The Glitch, and this is my new podcast, Advertising is Dead.